Hello, and welcome to the Water Research Foundation's webcast, Assessing Changes in Single-Family Water Use. I'm Maureen Hodgins, Research Manager at the Foundation, and today's moderator. The speakers are Peter Mayer of Aquacraft and Al Dietemann of Seattle Public Utilities and the Saving Water Partnership. First, I want to thank you, our subscribers, for supporting the Foundation's work. Our 1999 residential end uses study is an example of our research that was timely and provided practical results for the utilities. Now I want to briefly touch on the Foundation's resources and how you may access them. The September 2010 issue of our quarterly magazine, Drinking Water Research, featured our water efficiency research and can be accessed from our website. This slide shows some Foundation reports that are related to today's talk and how you can find them on our website. Note the 1999 residential end uses study. This slide shows some ongoing projects that you may want to keep an eye on, especially the new residential end uses project. Peter will touch on that later, but this is another example of our collaborative work with utilities, researchers like Aquacraft, and organizational partners like Alliance for Water Efficiency to make a powerful product. It features about $1 million in funding from the Foundation and 11 utilities. Today's webcast is based on talks Aquacraft has given earlier at Water Smart Innovations and at an AWWA section meeting in California, Nevada. But it has evolved since then, and we have added additional material for today from Al Dietemann. The two speakers are Al Dietemann from Seattle Public Utilities and Peter Mayer from Aquacraft. Al Dietemann has managed the water efficiency program for the City of Seattle and 17 wholesale water utilities for the past 24 years. Al has a total of 39 years working in the fields of water resources planning, water rights, water loss and leak detection, and demand management. Al is currently on the board of directors of the Alliance for Water Efficiency. Al leads the Saving Water Partnership team, which is made up of Seattle and 17 wholesale water utilities, with an annual budget of approximately $3 million. The partnership is meeting its annual goal of saving approximately 500,000 gallons of drinking water per day. In 2007, Al was honored at the national level when he was presented with the U.S. EPA's Water Efficiency Leader Award. In 2008, the Saving Water Partnership was named the WaterSense Promotional Partner of the Year by EPA. Peter Mayer is a professional engineer with Aquacraft. For the past 17 years, Peter's work has focused on studying urban water use patterns, water rate structures, determining the impacts of water conservation measures and programs, forecasting future demand, and water supply scenario analysis. Peter and Aquacraft have pioneered the use of flow data recorders and signal processing software to quantify where, when, and how water is used in homes and businesses. He was the lead author for the Foundation's 1999 study, Residential End Uses of Water. Subsequently, Aquacraft has done many other residential end use studies, which will be discussed today. Peter assisted with the creation of the Alliance for Water Efficiency, and he currently edits the Alliance's monthly online newsletter, Water Efficiency Watch. Peter is also the chair of the subcommittee to rewrite the AWWA M22 Sizing of Water Service Lines and Meters Manual. As for the agenda, we have 60 minutes total, with 45 minutes of presentation and 15 minutes of questions and answers. Al will start today's webcast with his perspective on single-family water consumption in Western Washington. Then Peter will tell us what he has learned from 15 years of residential end-use work with about 2,000 homes. Peter's talk will cover one Foundation report plus two EPA-funded studies and one study funded by the California Department of Water Resources. We will return to Al for some final notes on looking at end-use data in Western Washington. We will conclude with the question and answer session. To ask a question, you should be able to type that in on your screen in the question area at any time during the webcast. And with that, I will turn it over to Al.
Thank you very much. This is Al Dietemann, and good afternoon to everybody. First, I also want to acknowledge Bruce Flory, who is our senior economist and does a lot of our demand forecasting here with Seattle Public Utilities, He was a tremendous help to me in preparing the information that I'm going to be sharing with you today. Most utilities have been seeing lower water consumption, and that, I apologize for bouncing around here. And, of course, many of them, of course, attribute that to a downturn in the economy that we've all been seeing. And, of course, there are many utilities that have large commercial industrial customers, which can help explain that. But there are also a large number of water utilities across the country that have a majority of their water use coming from residential customers. And I think in the past, the people could more easily equate their future demands with their population growth. But in the 90s, we started to see trends change. And then in the last decade, I think a lot of folks began kind of scratching their head and saying, what is going on? Why are we breaking away from this trend where increasing population is not necessarily resulting in increased residential or single-family water use? And you can see the trend here in Seattle started way back, long before our current economic downturns, and single-family consumption. And again, to refresh folks, the blue is our Seattle direct service customers, and we have 17 wholesale customers in our saving water partnership as well as an average here. So that's why there's three lines on the bar here. But it's not just Seattle or our wholesale customers that are seeing these trends. I was able to get some information from Tacoma, a large utility to the south of Seattle, showing similar trends over time. And I think it's important to recognize that, that many utilities across the country are seeing declines in their single-family use. And as I said, they're searching for kind of why. Why is that happening? So when you look at a per-person use, so the first slide I showed was household. This is per-person. Of course, you see those same trends. So it's not necessarily dramatic changes in how many people are in the household. The trend is still holding firm. And the question, I think, then becomes, what components of single-family use might be causing or resulting in these changes? And therefore, I think it's the utility's best interest to take a look at those components or end uses of water and better identify and understand how those components might be changing over time. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Peter, and he's going to talk about end-use studies.
Well, thanks very much, Al. And thanks to everyone who has joined us for this webcast today. And I'd also like to extend thanks to the Water Research Foundation for putting this together and for inviting me and Al to talk to you today. So I'm going to talk about some of the research that we've been doing here at Aquacraft for the last 15 years or so and talk about how water use has changed in the residential sector and specifically, you know, where some of the changes have occurred. So I think it's not a surprise to anyone that to learn that residential water use is declining or in decline, has declined all across the country. The Water Research Foundation published in 2009 or 10 a study titled North American Residential Water Usage Trends Since 1992. And the conclusion of that research was that there had been an average reduction of about 12,000 gallons per household over a 30-year period from 1978 to 2008. Now, that may not sound like a huge decline for a 30-year period, and it's not. But the important thing to remember is that that analysis was done over a wide number of utilities and that the different parts of the country have experienced different levels of water use reduction in the residential sector. So some areas have experienced more dramatic reductions than 12,000 gallons, and some maybe not as much. The other point that I really am going to be trying to make it repeatedly today is that many of the reductions that we have seen have been observed prior to the current recession and occurred in indoor use. And so it's our impression that these savings are probably permanent or less likely to change than perhaps changes in outdoor use. And I just put up a bar chart from the city of Westminster, Colorado, where we've been doing some work recently, just showing their particular annual trends since 2000 that shows a fairly steady decline in water use. So the research I want to talk about today are four different studies that AquaCraft has been working on. The first one is the Residential End Uses of Water study, which was published in 1999. That is available for free download from the Water Research Foundation if you don't have a copy of that. The second one is a study which we refer to as the EPA Retrofit study. This was a study that was a follow-on to the Residential End Uses of Water study. And there were homes that were measured before and after appliances were retrofit. There was a more recent project that was completed in California, which is called the California Single Family Residential Water Use Study. And then there is a series of projects funded by the EPA looking at water use in new homes with two distinct study groups. One was a set of standard new homes that were built after 2001, sort of just a random selection, if you will, of new housing. And then there were some intentionally water-efficient homes that were built around 2006, and those homes were designed to meet the WaterSense new home specification. So the next slide takes a little bit closer look at these four different studies, since we're going to be talking about them as we go along so that you can understand a little bit more about where the data came from. The Residential End Use of Water study had a sample size of just under 1,200 houses, and those came from about 14 cities in the U.S. and Canada. The data for that study were collected between 1996 and 1998. The EPA Retrofit study had a total of 96 houses in it from three cities in the U.S. Those data were collected between 2000 and 2003. The California Single Family Water Use Efficiency Study had about 732 houses. Those came from 10 cities in California, data collected between 2006 and 2008. And then there were two separate samples from the EPA New Home Study. We had 302 houses that were standard new homes. So these are just sort of just regular off-the-shelf houses, nothing special, that were built after 2001. And then we also looked at 25 houses that were built to the WaterSense specification, and those came from two cities. And those are the most recent data that were collected, and that data was collected between 2009 and 2010. So then just jumping right into the comparison of what we found with these studies. This chart shows the indoor per capita water use in gallons per day that has been normalized for a family of three. And the normalization is important because there's a different number of people in a household in all of these different study groups. And so if you just compare, you know, average per capita use, you might find that you get a misleading result. So we like to look at it on a normalized basis when we're trying to do the comparisons across study groups. Now, the first three points on the graph come from what I'm calling the random sample studies, the residential end use study, the California single family study, and the EPA standard new homes. So those are sets of homes that were selected at random. The final two points are what I'm calling the intentionally efficient homes. Those were homes that were either retrofit or were built specifically to be water efficient. And I think that the graph sort of speaks for itself in terms of the trend. So you can see the oldest data is the residential end use of water study, and the indoor per capita use and per household use for that family of three has declined as we move forward in time and also looking at new houses. And then if you move again towards the intentionally efficient houses, you can see an even further reduction. And that's sort of pointing towards where we're headed to, I think, as more fixtures and appliances are retrofit and we see more changes occurring. So this is pretty clear documentation of a general declining trend in indoor residential water use. Now, thinking about per capita water use, one of the things that our research has uncovered, I don't think this is particularly startling, but it is that water demands do increase as you add people to the house. So as you go from 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 people in a household, yes, water use does increase, but it does not increase in a linear fashion. It actually increases following more what we would describe as a power curve. Now, this is an important distinction. So that means that as you add people to a house, the per capita use actually decreases a little bit because there are efficiencies of living together in a larger household. You only have to clean the floors, one time, whether you have one person or whether you have 6 people in the house. And this chart shows that if you use just a linear approach in evaluating per capita water use, you could result in some significant errors. And so the power curves that have come from these end use data provide a more accurate look at per capita use under different numbers of people in the household. Now, if we look at the curves, these power curve relationships for all of the 5 different sample groups plotted on the same graph, you can see then that, again, this declining trend where the residential end uses of water sample, the water use, that's the blue line, that's the highest, and then moving down, the water use is declining in that California sample, and then in the EPA standard new homes, the retrofit study, and then finally the most efficient group that we looked at is the homes that were built to meet the water sense specification. I'm going to jump to the next slide. This slide actually points out some of the differences if you look just at purely on a household basis or if you normalize for the family of 3. So the top line of this graph where it says mean gallon GPHD, which is gallons per household per day, that's just the average gallons per household per day not corrected by household size. And there you'll see that in the residential end use study, we found 177 gallons per household per day. And in California's single family study, it was 186 gallons per household per day. Well, you might think, whoa, they're using more water use in that California sample. Well, actually they're not, because there were more people per household in that sample. And so once you actually do that normalization for the number of people per household, you'll see that in the residential end use study, it was 60, for a family of 3, it was 62 gallons per person per day, and in California, it was 54. And then moving over to all the way to the water sense in the high efficiency new homes, they have got down to 36 gallons per person per day for indoor use. And so we had 2 studies now that have cracked that 40 gallons per capita ceiling, if you will, and I do believe that is probably where we are headed in the next 10 to 15 years for water use more broadly across North America as people install more efficient toilets, clothes washers, and other fixtures. So let's take a look at where some of these changes have occurred and talk about specific end uses of water. Yes, and there's a question again about indoor versus outdoor. Right now I'm just talking about indoor water use, and the per capita numbers that I'm presenting are for indoor use only. Okay, if we look at indoor household use by end use, we see that the biggest changes that have been observed by comparing these studies is in toilets and clothes washers. So those are the first 2 sets of bars. And again, we have all of the 5 different sample groups presented here. These data have not been normalized for a family of 3. These are just the raw per household data. So the California numbers would probably look even more would be even lower if had they been normalized in this case. But you can see a sharp decline in change in toilet usage, a sharp decline in change in clothes washer usage. In shower usage, there's a sort of a mixed result where you know water showering use is lower in some studies. That it's not as clear a trend as you see from toilets and clothes washers. Shower use, of course, is much more discretionary depending upon the person taking the shower, and that also can be more influenced by a smaller sample size, for instance. Faucet use, with the exception of the California study where it was a little higher, there has been a decline generally in faucet use. Leakage, again, a more mixed result. The other category includes a variety of different things, kind of depends on the locality, but it could include cooling for swamp coolers or humidification if that occurs. Bathtub water uses remain fairly constant, and dishwasher use, we've seen slight declines. Dishwasher use is quite small, so in general, you have to have probably fairly large samples to be able to show significant changes in dishwasher use. But we do know that dishwashers have gotten more efficient as time has gone by. All right, I want to focus now a little bit on the toilet category. Toilets have been historically the largest end use indoors. I think that in some houses, clothes washing is higher than toilets, but in general, toilet flushing water use is the highest use. Now, this chart shows three different distributions of toilet flushes. One is from the residential end use study, one is from the standard new homes, and the other is from the high efficiency water sense specification houses. And this basically plots the frequency of flushing in all of those studies. And the blue is the residential end use study. And you can see there that there's quite a large number of flushes that occurred in that higher volume range, and 3.5 gallons per flush, going all the way up to even 7 or 8 gallons per flush in some cases. Remember, those data came from the late 1990s and included a lot of older houses. The plumbing codes, the law was signed in 1992 to require toilets to be 1.6 gallons per flush or less, probably came into actual effect closer to 1995, and we're still in a situation where we see some flush volumes higher than 1.6. And I wanted to talk about that because with that, the group of standard new homes, and these were homes that were built since 2001, we found a rather surprising number of toilet flushes that exceeded the 1.6 gallons per flush level. And so this is just looking at the flush distribution from that sample of standard new homes that were built since 2001, about 300 houses. So in this case, we found that there was, approximately about 40% or more of the toilet flushes that were higher than 1.6 gallons per flush in these homes that we had expected would all be equipped with 1.6 gallons per flush toilets. Now, we weren't able to get into these houses to, investigate whether it was, misadjusted toilets or whether there actually were, toilets that were not designed for 1.6 gallons per flush. But I think it's an indication that even in new houses, you may not get the full impact of the plumbing codes. Hopefully this is something that's going to be changing and improving in the future, but the results from this study suggest that there's still some higher flush volume toilet fixtures that are out there or that were being installed in new homes in the early 2000s. We look at clothes washers, we can see a fairly steady decline in the average volume, the load volume. So that's the total amount of water that it takes to wash a load of clothes in a clothes washer. In the residential end use study, the average clothes washer used just under 41 gallons per load. In California, it was only a little bit less at 39. But in, once we start to look at some of the other samples, we can see a dramatic change. In the standard new homes, a 33.5 gallons, and then the intentionally efficient homes where we installed what we knew to be Energy Star high-efficiency clothes washers, you can see really a more dramatic impact, 24.3 gallons for the retrofit study that was done in the early 2000s. And then in the homes that were built to the water specification, we put in really, we specified highly water-efficient clothes washers, and the average load volume was only 15.1 gallons per load. There are a lot more products on the market today that use in that 15 to 20 gallon per load range than there ever have been before. And so I would anticipate that is the direction that we're going to see clothes washing moving in the future. Leakage remains an issue for all of these studies. Even in new houses, we still find leakage either from toilet flappers, from leaking faucets, from a variety of different places. The thing that we've consistently found, though, is that the leakage rates are skewed. There are a large number of houses that leak very little, and that's what this chart shows, is that we had about 46% of the houses that leaked 10 gallons per day or less, so between 0 and 10 gallons per day. But there's 7% of the houses that are leaking more than 100 gallons per household per day. Now, that is a lot of leakage. And those are households that could definitely benefit from a reduction in their leakage volume. Now, if we look at, like, if those same sets of houses in terms of the volume that they're leaking, about those 7% of houses that leaked over 100 gallons per day were responsible for greater than 40% of all of the leakage in the study. So, again, this is a challenge, I would say, for water utilities who are seeking to reduce residential demand. How can you identify customers with high leakage rates and assist them? Because it's not something that needs to be generally addressed by everyone in the service area. It's a limited number of customers who experience this problem. And I think this is an area where technology may help us out quite a bit in the future. A lot of the new automatic meter infrastructure technology enables more frequent reading and interrogation of water meters that can identify unusual flows, let's say, overnight. And as utilities begin implementing this, you'll see the capability of alerting customers, hey, we noticed that you had some really, extensive water use, at a time when, normally there isn't any. And so I'm optimistic that this is an area where improvement is possible. So one other area that we have tried to look at for these studies is to examine what percentage of the homes in each of these studies meet some efficiency criteria. And for this chart, we're looking at an efficiency criteria for toilets and for clothes washers. Now, you can argue about what the specific criteria were, but I'll tell you what we used for this example. We looked at houses where the average flush volume of that house was less than 2 gallons per flush. So that means if you take all the toilet flushes in the house and you calculate an average, if that average is less than 2 gallons per flush, then we'll say, okay, that meets an efficiency criteria. For clothes washers, we established a criteria of 30 gallons per load. So if the average load volume for a household was less than 30 gallons per load, we classified that as an efficient clothes washing house. But you can see in the residential end uses of water study, we had only 10% of those houses that met our toilet efficiency criteria, and even smaller, only 3% met the clothes washing criteria. Now, that was back in the late 1990s. So the 1.6-gallon per flush toilets were fairly new at that point, and really most people had top-loading clothes washers, and you know, the horizontal axis clothes washers were just starting to be introduced into the market. So perhaps not so surprising. We moved then to the California single-family study. Now, remember, this is a random sample of homes from California, and the data were collected in the mid to late 2000s. Now, here we had 30% of the households who met that toilet efficiency criteria, and 30% also met the clothes washer criteria. So that's some substantial improvement from what we found with the residential end use. If we look at the standard new homes, so the sort of off-the-shelf new homes, it gets better yet. 48% of the homes met that toilet efficiency criteria, and 39% met that clothes washer criteria. Now, you might think 48% is pretty good. To me, that's a little disappointing because I would have hoped that all of the homes built since 2001 could have met the toilet efficiency criteria, but apparently not. Now, if we look at the final sample, the high-efficiency homes that were built since 2006 specifically to meet the water sense specification, in this case, 100% of these houses were able to meet that clothes washer efficiency specification. Surprisingly, perhaps, there was a very small percentage of those homes that didn't meet the toilet criteria. So that means even when you're doing your utmost to try and ensure a high level of efficiency for toilet flushing, there's still going to be either some products, some misadjustments, or some issues that can impact toilet flush volume. On the other hand, 96% meeting criteria is still pretty darn good. So when we do our analysis, we survey each of the houses as well as collecting end-use data with our data logger technology. And when we can combine then the water use data and the survey response data to take a look at different factors that impact water use. So you know, what is on a consistent level impacting and changing water use at the residential level? So one thing that's fairly obvious is the number of residents. So the number of people in the household has a distinct impact on the water use of that household. And as you add residents, you add water use to that house. Okay, not a big surprise there. The presence of leaks greater than 100 gallons per household per day was also a factor. So if you ignore less than 100 gallons per day, you can't necessarily tell a difference between households. But if they're a high leaking household, then that is a factor that has a strong influence on water use. The presence of high-efficiency toilets and clothes washers is a factor that reduces water use, statistically, we found. Now, here's something interesting. The presence of a child or a youth in the household increases water use less than adding an additional adult. So let's say you have three adults in one house versus one adult and two children. The house with the one adult and two children is likely to use less water. Now, this may fly in the face of some beliefs of teenagers, you know, spending long times in the shower. They do sometimes, but what this is saying is that on average, a child adds less water use to a household than an adult. And finally, the presence of having both a garbage disposal and a dishwasher together resulted in less water use, and actually was faucet use in particular. And this is something that we found from our analysis of the California data, and it's one of the first times that we've been able to see what appears to be the efficiency of having a dishwasher in your house versus washing dishes by hand. And, this is something that we've suspected for quite a while because dishwashers really, they can wash a load of dishes on 5, 6, 7 gallons per load. That's generally less water than you can wash that same number of dishes by hand. And for the first time, we were able to show that statistically. All right, I want to switch gears a little bit and look at outdoor water use. Up till now, I've been focusing almost entirely on indoor water use patterns. So we can do the same type of analysis on what are the factors that that impact outdoor water use. And these are the ones that have fallen out through our statistical analysis. The first is the net ET, and ET is the evapotranspiration rate. That's basically a measurement of the climate. So perhaps this is very obvious, but in hotter and drier climates, people use more water outdoors on average than they do in cool and wet climates. The irrigated area of the house, so that's the square footage that they're actually applying water to. You have more area, you will use more water outdoors. Income is the factor that affects outdoor water use. So a house in a wealthier area, you're more likely to have higher outdoor water use than in a lower income area. The landscape ratio, which is a measurement of the relative water requirement of the landscape, this essentially means that landscapes that are designed to use less water, so water-wise landscapes are xeriscape, they do in fact tend to use less water than landscapes which have a higher water requirement, with plantings that need more water. If there is a swimming pool at the house, we have found that homes with swimming pools use more water outdoors than homes without swimming pools. Then there's also a factor which we call excess irrigation. So we look at what was the amount of water that was applied to the landscape, and we compare that against the evapotranspiration requirement. And if they applied more than the evapotranspiration requirement, then we classify that house as being an excess irrigator. And yes, and if they were an excess irrigator, that of course meant that they had higher outdoor water use. And finally, and a very important factor in that affects outdoor water use is the presence of an in-ground sprinkler system. And this has been a finding that goes all the way back to the very first study that I did with Aquacraft in the 1994-95. Homes that are equipped with in-ground automatic irrigation use substantially more water outdoors than homes that manually irrigate. It's just easier to apply a lot more water. They might also have a higher quality of landscape, too, but that's not something that we were looking for at this point. We're just looking at water use. Now, for two of our studies, we were able to compare some specific outdoor water use parameters to try to look at some of the changes. This is looking at the random sample of homes in California, and then the random sample of standard new homes that were built since 2001. Now here we could see that the average lot size from those older homes in California was about 9,200 square feet, and it was about 1,000 square feet bigger in the new homes. So their homes are a little bit bigger. Their average irrigated area was also a little bit bigger. Their outdoor water use, though, in the standard new homes was a little bit less on average. But the actual application rate, the amount of, so the depth of irrigation water that was applied, came out to be about the same. And this is a factor, you'll say, well, wait a second, the average water use was more in one. And this is where statistics can play a trick on you, because averages are often thrown off by outliers. So you have several houses with small lots and very high irrigation rates or large lots and very low rates that can change those numbers. But one of the things that the very bottom line of this is something that I found, the average excess irrigation. So this is, if we look at the people who apply, who did over-irrigate, and what level of excess was occurring, we found that the level of excess in the newer homes was lower than it was in the existing homes. So that suggests that perhaps there is some improvement going on in irrigation technology, so that newer systems are doing a little better in that regard. So thinking a little bit more about outdoor use, it's clearly more variable than indoor use. It's much more regionally specific. It's much more difficult to compare outdoor use, between utilities or across regions. It's much more elastic than indoor use. So it's, when a utility changes their pricing, it's much more likely to impact outdoor use rather than indoor use. outdoor use is also what's much more likely to change as a result of a recession or an economic factors versus indoor use. And it's also subject to more frequent utility intervention. I mean, outdoor use is usually where utilities go for drought response. And that's also where a lot of irrigation rules are applied. Well, in our experience, one of the best ways to try and target outdoor use from a water efficiency perspective is to establish a water budget for each of the households in the service area based on the landscape area and the climate. Once you do that, you can compare sort of your empirical measurement of, well, this is a reasonable amount of outdoor water for this particular property, and you can compare that against what they actually use. And then that gives you the ability then to identify customers who are really applying an excessive amount of irrigation. The final point I want to make is that I think we can expect outdoor use to fluctuate in the future. Temperatures increase, it's very possible outdoor water use is going to increase, provided that it's not restricted by the utility. In an unconstrained situation, I think outdoor water use is definitely likely to increase as temperature increases. So if you're planning and you're thinking about how to incorporate climate change into your long-term planning, this is something you definitely need to think about. To summarize some of the findings related to indoor water use, switching back to indoor water use again, I think we've shown through these data that single-family water use is decreasing both on a household and a per capita basis. We've seen significant changes in toilets and clothes washers, smaller changes in other end uses, but the big movers are toilets and clothes washers. We have seen significant indoor reductions in off-the-shelf new homes. However, as I showed earlier, some issues with toilet flushing remain, and that there are still some higher volume toilets or misadjusted toilets out there that are using more water than anticipated. Homes that are designed to be intentionally efficient really are intentionally efficient, and I think we can expect that once the economy gets back on track and home building starts up again, home builders are likely to adopt that water sense specification more and more, and that is going to result in homes that use substantially less water. I think we can also expect changes, further reductions in indoor use. There's still a lot of old toilets that are still out there, and they are going to wear out at some point. People will redo their bathrooms, and clothes washers have a expected useful life of about 14 years. So we're going to be reaching the point where there's a lot of top loaders that are going to be replaced. So there is room for further reductions as we move forward. Leakage is the big challenge. We know leakage can be reduced, but it's going to take some technological changes and possibly some interventions on behalf of utilities. Or other technologies, at least, to alert customers to leakage, because it's largely something that people are not aware of or able to take action about on a consistent basis. How am I doing for time here, Maureen?
We're about 1:45 by my clock, actually like 17:02, but we can go a few minutes.
All right, I'm just going very quickly through my final few slides here. I think I've covered most of these points already, but if you're doing planning for the future, I would plan for reduced indoor use and variable outdoor use. There's a lot of concern about revenue loss, and that's a big issue with rates. My sort of mantra on this one is you can conserve water or don't conserve water. Your rates are going to go up. The fact of the matter is that costs are increasing whether conservation is occurring or not. And if conservation really is your lowest cost source of new supply, then the rates should be going up less than they would be if you were meeting that demand through some other methods. not always the easiest point to make to explain to customers, but it's one that has to be made. And hopefully people can minimize rate increases by avoiding, overbuilding infrastructure. So thinking about future recommendations, if you can use your billing data to target high-demand customers, that's the best, how you get the most bang for your buck out of your conservation program. And if you can look beyond the billing data to the end-use level, you can improve the analysis even more. In the future, it's going to help to get to know your customers better, know how they're using water, where they're using water, and some sampling and measurements of demands can be really useful. There's some excellent conservation tracking tools and forecasting tools that are available now. The Alliance for Water Efficiency has one that's available for free to all members of the Alliance. And it's very important that you evaluate the effectiveness of your conservation programs, because they're not always doing exactly what you expect them to do. And finally, there's two studies that I wanted to alert you to. One is going to be coming out very soon. We've completed the final report for a project that was in Albuquerque, which was also a retrofit study. And we measured water use before and after replacing all the fixtures and appliances. Those homes have the lowest per capita and per household use that we have measured yet, so even lower than we found for the WaterSense homes that I presented today. So you can look for that. And then, of course, the expanded residential end uses of water study, where we have more 26 utilities participating. That's still a few years out, but I think that should be some very interesting results. And with that, I'm going to pass it back to Al Dedeman.
We can't hear Al right now, Al.
Okay, it's not working. Can I hear me now?
Yep.
Okay, the handset's not working. So a lot of utilities are asking, well, what's the future trends? Peter's done a great job, I think, of laying out the historical trends. You could begin to see dips, but how does that translate in the crystal ball into future water use for single-family homes? And so I'm going to begin to show you how we use the end-use data to help us with our demand forecasting in the future. One technique is to combine the actual end-use data that we collect with survey results to begin to look at how customers might be changing their end uses over time. One thing we did was do a more comprehensive survey with our customers to find out what they currently have and how fast they were replacing that equipment. And I'm going to concentrate now on toilets and clothes washers, because those are the typically the largest indoor uses of water in the home. Outdoor use nationally, as Peter said, varies quite a bit depending on climate and weather. But we can talk fairly specifically and very relevantly to utilities across the country about toilets and clothes washers. So these are going to be my examples. And what we did find was for single-family customers, the toilet changeout is happening on a fairly regular basis, a predictable basis, and it's happening with or without utility intervention, in other words, with or without financial incentives. The financial incentives only accelerate the replacement of the toilets. Clothes washers, right now we're at about 21.5 gallons per household per day on an average basis. But back in 2006, we were only at 30% of our customers with efficient washers. And our current market share, 77% of customers, when they buy a new washer, are buying an efficient model. So you can see how quickly that's going to change over time. Right now, over 50% of the models purchased are efficient. And locally, because we have had financial incentives on clothes washers, we got up to 77%. And this is an interesting thing to keep in mind. A lot of people know folks that have a 20 or 25-year-old clothes washer, but the average clothes washer
is quite a bit younger, and so there's a higher turnover of these clothes washers. And as the clothes washers turn over in the future, it's going to result in more savings. So what does that mean to a utility? Back in 1996, what was our average single-family consumption for a clothes washer? You can see about 25-some gallons. And when we look at the market share changes and we look at the trends that are happening, we can easily see that there's about another 11 gallons or 8% of our total single-family use, which is going to be happening in the future as folks become more and more efficient. The 2040 number is kind of the state of the art of current technology with clothes washers. Not to say that by 2040 there won't be more efficient clothes washers, but just taking that and saying, okay, by 2040 all of our customers will have a technology that's currently available to our customers today would result in that dramatic change in single-family water use. And I don't think a lot of utilities are really thinking about that. So looking at it a little bit differently, here's the demand with and without the clothes washer savings I just talked about. And you can see the impact of that on our demands over time. So in conclusion, the end-use data helps us understand the consumption trends historically, and it helps to give us a little vision as to where these trends might be headed in the future. That and our survey work provides us some insights as to where we're going. And so if utilities have really updated and know their current end-use information, they shouldn't really be surprised by some of the changes that they're seeing in single-family consumption. And so this is our overall single-family demand forecast. And the passive savings are the savings that are going to happen if utilities not necessarily are intervening with their conservation programs. So our education and the incentive programs are the green line. The darker brown-orange line is what we forecast from price. But look at the size of the purple over time and how significant that is in reducing our projected single-family demands. And I think that purple area is the area that most utilities are missing or not really thinking about when they're really looking at their future demand forecast. The significance of just the toilets and the clothes washers alone will produce most of that savings. So now we're at the question and answer session, and we'll try and take some questions as they come.
Okay, this is Maureen Hodgins again. I'll be moderating the questions. We had hoped to kind of get the presentation done like maybe 7 minutes earlier, so I think we might just hold over 7 minutes longer. We've got about 20 questions, and I will read off the question, and then Peter or Al will answer it. The first question that I have is do you have data how many customers actually do you have data on how many customers actually repair their leaks when they have been notified about the leaks?
No, I don't have data on that as part of these studies, no.
There's another question for Peter, and it's about the garbage disposal findings.
Mm-hmm.
And is there an explanation why having a garbage disposal with a dishwasher results in less water use? There are a couple questions around.
Yeah, you know, it's a little bit ubiquitous. Garbage disposals are so common that there are very few houses that don't have garbage disposals at this point. So they're linked together. I don't have a really good answer except to say that just about everybody has a garbage disposal, and so. But when we considered houses that didn't have them, the finding wasn't significant. So it was a paired finding.
Okay. Here's another question here, kind of a broader view. Are there any cities in the U.S. with financial incentives to change water use, for example, by having – this one's from Australia their example is having a low cost-based supply of water, and then later on, you know, after you get above that, having a much higher price of water. And,
oh, yes, that's a very common way of charging for water in the United States, and some sort of an increase in block rate structure. There's all different varieties of that rate structure that we use.
Okay. There's another question wondering, with any of this work, were you able to consider behavior and education and comparing it to water use and how either of those would play a role?
Well, I think behavior and education does play a role. In these studies, we are looking mostly at technological changes. We do have data, though, on behavioral components of water use. And I know that there was a question on showering, so I can answer two in one here, because there's a question about why the gallons per day was higher for showers in the new efficient homes. So this relates directly to behavior. In the residential end-use study, the oldest study that I talked about today, we found that the average shower flow volume was about 2.2 gallons per minute. Now, the maximum allowable right now is 2.5 gallons per minute. So we found even in the late 1990s, people were either behaviorally or through technology preferred to shower at a lower flow rate than even was mandated or than was allowed. Now that's significant because that means it's harder to impact changes in showering just by changing out the shower head. I mean, if someone's already showering at 2.2 gallons per minute and you replace their shower head with, you know, maybe a 2.2 or a 2.1 gallon per minute head, you're not going to get a lot of change there. So the change has to come by encouraging people either to take shorter showers or gosh forbid, less frequent showers.
Okay, there was a similar question when you were showing the summary of findings for the indoor, and that was slide 31. There was a question, so what's your summary for showers and baths? So do you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, I think for showering, we've looked at a number of interventions. I think the Albuquerque results, which were not as part of this presentation, but will be coming out soon, there I think we are able to show an impact from super high efficient shower heads. And that may be one of the first times that we've seen a real impact from shower head changeouts. And that's largely because there just hasn't been a big enough difference between what we were taking out and what we were putting in. The other thing that we found is that as the shower flow rates decrease, you know, there is a small increase in duration of showers. So people do sometimes take a little bit longer showers with a lower flow rate shower head. So that's something that might need to be addressed through some kind of behavior change effort. In terms of bathtubs, you know, a bathtub is a fixed volume of water. There's not really a lot of water savings to be achieved through bathtubs because, you know, it's fill it up and that's it.
Okay. I've heard this question a lot. Do you have any estimates of how much the recession is contributing to lower water use?
No, but the point that I'm trying to make today is that it's probably contributing to lower outdoor water use to a much greater extent than to lower indoor water use. I don't think people have stopped flushing the toilet or taking showers related to the recession. They're much more likely to turn down their irrigation system related to the recession.
Here's another question about outdoor water use. Did you look for or notice any correlation between excess outdoor water use and the size of irrigated area?
I don't have an answer on that one. I think we did, but I could be happy to check on that and respond offline.
Yeah, and any questions that we don't get to today, we will post to questions and answers within a week, so we can catch any questions there that weren't answered today. Someone is asking about the leakage for the indoor study. What is the data source for the leakage?
Well, it's the same source that all the data comes from. This is from the flow recorders, so we monitor water use every 10 seconds in order to determine the end uses. And leakage either appears as a continuous low capper leak, it looks like a repeated refilling of a toilet. And those are the most, the toilet flapper leaks are the largest leak, cause of leakage in the house.
Okay, and then here's another question about the indoor study, and you were talking about the toilets and the flushing. It was slide 25 around there. So the question is, for gallons per flush, does that represent a single flush or people flushing more than once for a single use?
So I didn't talk about flushing frequency, but when we calculate the average gallons per flush, we're looking at all of the toilet flushes. So whether it was flushed once or twice, it doesn't matter. It's all the toilet flushes. And then you calculate the average. Now, we have looked at flushing frequency and related to installing of lower flow toilets, and this is an important finding because we have not found that flushing increases as you install lower volume toilets. So, in other words, people are still flushing the toilet about the same number of times regardless of the volume of the fixture that they're using.
We have quite a few questions that came in recently, so I'm just trying to sort them out now. I have one for Al. How did Seattle conduct its study?
We participated in the earlier end-use study where we had the direct metering. We've also done a separate metering of homes that were for sale where we could get in and measure actual fixture use. Without unduly disturbing the residents at that place. We've also done what we call an attribution study, which is a survey that's paired with the actual customer's water use. So if the customer says, yeah, I had a leak and I fixed it, we can look at their consumption historically and into the future to see what difference that might have made in their total water use. So we can compare when customers say, yeah, I changed my washer or changed my toilet out or I made modifications to my irrigation system. We can look at that in a context of their survey responses and their actual water use pre and post that survey. And that gives us a lot of information about kind of what's effective and what customers are doing. And we followed up with that with a very small sample of what I call truth where we actually went in and took a look to see whether the customers were actually kind of telling us what we wanted to hear, which is frequently the case in surveys, or whether they were actually doing it. And we were quite confident that we were getting pretty good responses from the majority of our customers regarding the actions they were taking and then, of course, the resulting consumption values. So those are the techniques that we used to verify and kind of truth our information and feel with a pretty good level of confidence that we know what's going on.
Okay, and here's a question for Peter probably. How can we get or determine demand factors to use in estimating what a household will use both indoor and outdoor?
Well, we put together some fairly simple models that you can use, and so they're printed in the Residential End Uses and Water Study has one of those models and some of the others studies also, and it's basically an equation, and so you can then put in factors that are specific to your service area and develop an estimate. I recently built a water calculator for the Alliance for Water Efficiency that will enable, it'll be a web-based thing, and people will be able to go in and put in basic information and estimate water use with that, and that calculator uses some of the models and curves that we've developed through these end-use studies.
Here's an interesting question about the future. Can you provide an overall estimate of per capita decrease in consumption for the next 20 years?
Well, no. That would pretty much be a guess at this point. I think these data show that we're headed towards 40 gallons per person per day indoors and possibly less, moving forward.
And I gave an estimate for just clothes washers, but I put back the chart here that shows our price and conservation savings and passive savings to give people an idea of how we see those components interacting into the future. As far as per capita goes, we're looking at a pretty steady decline here the next few years of 0.75% to 1% reductions in per capita use, at least out over the next 10 to 20 years as these technologies become more and more pervasive in our service area.
There was a question early on about how do you normalize for the number of people? Like,
yeah, I wrote the answer to that question, but we're just using those power curve relationships. So you establish, you use the raw data to develop that curve relationship, and then you just calculate for three people based on each curve for each study, and then that's how you do the comparison.
Okay, and let's see. We should end in about 2 minutes here, and I just wanted, there were a lot of questions about the PDF of the slides and where to get some of the studies that were cited, so I'm just going to take the remaining time to tell you that. I want to thank Peter and Al for sharing with us all the insights they've learned from working in the field for so long. So we had a problem with creating the PDF of the slides, so you would have the handout during the presentation. I apologize for that. It may have been fixed during the presentation, and you might be able to refresh your screens and be able to download it now. If that does not work, there will be one on our website. If you go to this webcast, you will see an archive of the PowerPoint. And like I said before, within a week, if your question was not answered, we will have a list of the questions and answers posted on our website for you. Peter mentioned the 1999 Water Research Foundation funded study for the residential end uses. You can find that on our website. If you look on the, I think the second slide, it will give you the report number, maybe the third slide, and you just type that into our website under report, under the search function, and you can find it, and you can download that, and even non-subscribers can download that. Peter, can you tell people where they can find those EPA studies?
Yeah, all of the other studies are available for free download from the Aquacraft's website, www.aquacraft.com. As you click on the reports tab, then you'll see the full listing, and those are available for free download. And many of these reports are also available for free download from the Alliance for Water Efficiency.
Okay, great. And with that, again, I want to thank all of you for your time today and to Peter and Al. And this will conclude the presentation. But for the audience members, can you just hang on for a moment? We have two really customer kind of input questions, polling questions. So once this concludes, they should pop up, and it's pretty basic, like, did you learn anything today and can you use it? And we're just doing that for all of our webcasts to just be able to serve you better. So hang on for those two polling questions. Thank you.